Hi everybody, I'm Samay. Super excited to be giving a talk this year again at Citus Con. I had a great experience giving the talk last year. And for this year's talk, I wanted to focus on high-write workloads specifically. Many times when you are tuning Postgres, you end up tuning one or two parameters when you have write-heavy workloads without understanding the bigger picture of what's going on. And that's the thing I wanted to talk about, explain the concepts behind tuning high-write workloads for Postgres, and then dive deeper into the specific configurations which matter to make that happen. So this talk is titled Optimizing Postgres for Write-Heavy Workloads, featuring checkpointer and WAL configs. A bit about myself, I am Samay Sharma. I manage the open source Postgres team at Microsoft. Our goal is to make contributions to open source Postgres to make it better for everybody. I've been working with Postgres for over a decade now, within multiple roles as an extension developer at Citus, and then working mainly with customers for 6 to 7 years, helping them get the most out of their Postgres setup. And one of the passions I developed as a part of that journey is making it easier for people using Postgres to understand Postgres performance and tuning and the internals of it in a very simple way, without having to spend as many years to do it as I had. So before we go into the detailed content of this talk around making Postgres optimizations, it's important that we understand the context in which we make these optimizations. A lot of the problems you will face as a user are going to be solvable maybe without tuning Postgres. So I wanted to cover some of the basics in that regard. So the first thing is make sure that your application and the database server are set up in a way that the latency between them is low. It matters a lot for high-write workloads, specifically for OLTP ones, because you're always kind of sending data from the client or the Postgres application to the database. You can do that by placing them in the same data center. If you are deploying on the cloud, make sure that your application VM and the database server are both in the same region. You can use accelerated networking and other kind of things depending on your setup. The second thing to know is typically connections in Postgres are expensive. And when you're kind of having a high concurrency workload, you tend to make a lot of connections to the database to do a lot of writes. It's very important to either use long-lived connections so that you are not kind of wasting the connection establishment time again and again, or you're using a connection pooler like pgbouncer. And thirdly, you want to make sure that you have the right hardware to support your workload. Like if you expect your application to generate 100 megabytes of writes per second, but have a database server which can support only 25 megabytes of writes per second, obviously that's not a situation which is going to work. So before we dive into Postgres, it's important to have the right setup. And secondly, it's important to make sure you're doing the right things from an application point of view. So what are some of the common reasons why you will get lower write performance than you would expect? The most common one I've seen is having too many indexes, or having indexes which are not being used, or having different types of indexes. So what indexes are always a trade-off between reads and writes. And whenever you add more and more indexes, every write you do has to go and update those indexes. So make sure that the indexes you have are the ones you need. And the indexes, like for example, make sure you don't have extra columns in the indexes. You don't have too much randomness when you're writing to indexes, because random indexes very often generate 2 to 3x more I/O than a sequential index, for example. So like, make sure that your index usage is well thought out. The second thing you should do is to parallelize your loading jobs with concurrent connections. That's very important, because if you're doing OLTP workloads, you want to make sure that the writes, you can kind of bypass the effect of the latency by having many parallel connections. If you're doing bulk loads currently, let's say the copy command can only use one core. So if you want to use all the cores to do data loading, it's beneficial to use concurrency. Also, batching always helps, and batching doesn't mean that you need to kind of compromise the real-timeness of your application. just micro batching by batching for a second, batching every 10,000 or 100,000 rows and uploading them as a copy command will give you much better throughput compared to if you were doing it with single row inserts. Partitioning is another idea which is very useful and beneficial. And generally, people view partitioning as being a very read-heavy benefit. However, on the write side also, it can be very beneficial because now you have many small tables, you have smaller indexes to update when you are making writes, and also other processes can become much faster because you have smaller tables. And lastly, for ephemeral data, for data which is part of your staging tables, which is part of your loading job, which you don't need to kind of persist, it's very useful to use unlocked tables so that you don't have to necessarily write a lot of WAL for tables which you don't necessarily need from a durability standpoint. So all of these things you can do today in your application to make it write faster. Now, let's say you've done all of these things and still you want to squeeze more performance out of your database. That's what this talk is majorly going to be focused on, is how do you understand how writes work in Postgres and how you tune them by changing Postgres configurations. So before we dive into how to tune it, it's important for us to understand how a write happens in Postgres. So when you make a write, firstly, it's written to the WAL, which is Postgres's write ahead log for durability reasons. So if the database crashes, you can replay the writes from the WAL and it'll get back to the current state. Then you make a write into shared buffers, which is Postgres's buffer pool. And then you acknowledge the write to the user. Now, the first question which might be popping in your head is, when are we going to write this to disk? Because if my database crashes, I want to make sure as much data is persisted on disk as possible. So that is done in Postgres by two processes. One of them is called background writer, and the other is called checkpointer. Based on different criteria, they write out the contents of shared buffers onto disk. Now, we'll talk about each of them, but let's start with checkpointer for now. Now, one of the caveats of the way I explained how things work is after a crash, you need to replay all of the writes with the WAL. But you don't know where to start because these background processes are kind of making those writes, but you don't know exactly how much WAL you need to keep and which parts of buffers are already written, which queries are already written. So that context, it's very important to have a point before which you know everything has been written to disk. Because then next time you have to run recovery, you can run from the last what is called checkpoint, and then you can just replay the writes from there. So that's why Postgres has a concept of a checkpoint, which guarantees that all the dirty buffers until that point are written to disk. So basically, whenever you need to recover, you can simply start from the last checkpoint, play the WAL, which needs to be replayed before it can be recycled. So now that we know what are the processes involved in a typical write-heavy scenario, it's important for us to understand which are the kind of background processes we need to tune for healthy long-term operation. And there are three main ones I'd like to talk about today. The first one is auto vacuum. The second is checkpointer and WAL. The third is the background writer. All components we discussed a bit in kind of the previous slide. I'll dive into each of them in the upcoming slides. Let's start with auto vacuum. So auto vacuum is Postgres's way of removing unneeded row versions. Because Postgres uses MVCC semantics, it maintains multiple row versions at the same time. So if you do an update or a delete, that row is not necessarily deleted instantly, but its copy is still retained in case older transactions which have access to that row still want to use it. And after nobody needs those row versions, auto vacuum comes and starts cleaning up those rows. To decide which tables to clean up, it checks if tables have been significantly modified. And if so, it runs the vacuum and analyze commands for it. The defaults for auto vacuum are not very well tuned for high write workloads, which is why it's important to understand if auto vacuum is able to keep up with your workload, and if not, what you need to tweak. The common auto vacuum problems start with vacuum not being triggered very often for large tables. That happens because the way auto vacuum decides when to trigger a vacuum is based on when a percentage of the table changes. So the default, which is 0.2, indicates that if 20% of the table changes, I'm going to trigger a vacuum for this table. Obviously, for a table, let's say, which has billion rows, 20% is 200 million rows of bloat, right? Which is more than what you want. So in those cases, it might be beneficial, or in most cases, it is beneficial to actually reduce this to something like 0.02 or even 0.002, depending on how much bloat you can deal with in your application. The other thing, other common problem which happens is vacuum is running slow. There are many ways to speed it up. I won't go into all the details because I gave a talk on this topic last year and I'll kind of point you to it. But fundamentally, auto vacuum has something called cost limits to stop itself, to slow itself down, to avoid impacting user queries. And for that reason, for that reason, it has cost limits, which you can disable or kind of reduce the cost limiting for high write workloads, because there you actually have to do that work. It's not unnecessary work and it has to be done. You could also increase the amount of memory and CPU you give to auto vacuum using some of the parameters we discussed in this slide. The other thing which can happen, which is normally not very easy to catch, is when you have vacuum is running, auto vacuum is running fine, but you're not able to clean dead rows due to some other processes holding on to those rows. It could be other queries, it could be replication slots, it could be prepared transactions. So it's important for us to detect that and to kind of clear that up so that vacuum can do its job. So I covered some of the concepts in this talk, but I gave a detailed auto vacuum talk last year where we dive into each of these auto vacuum problems, how you detect them with queries, and how you solve them with specific solutions. So I strongly recommend to kind of go and listen to that talk if you're interested in really figuring out the best auto vacuum configuration for your setup. Let's move on to the second piece I talked about, which is the check pointer. So how do you say that the check pointer operation is healthy for your database or not? How do you create a balance between making sure checkpoints are done frequently enough, but are not being done unnecessarily? One of the factors you need to keep in mind is you need to have a reasonable recovery time for your database. If that's super important, you want to increase the frequency of checkpoints, because only after a checkpoint you replay the wall. And if there is a lot of wall to replay because your checkpoint was done a day ago, that will reduce your recovery, increase your recovery time significantly. You also don't want to do checkpoints too often, because you will keep, let's imagine that you have a 1 hour checkpointing time, and then every 5 minutes you change the same buffer again and again. If you were doing checkpoints every 5 minutes, you would write that buffer each time. But if you're doing the checkpoint in every hour, you'd probably write it only once instead of 12 times. So that's a big win in terms of reducing the total amount of I/O. So if you do checkpoints too often, you will increase the total I/O on the system. But I'll discuss in the next slides on how you make that trade-off. So before we tune it, we need to understand when checkpoints are triggered. You can trigger them with manual actions, such as just running the checkpoint command or running other commands which will run a checkpoint for you, like pg start backup or stopping the database cleanly and things like that. However, when in an automated manner, checkpoints are run when either a particular amount of time has passed since the last checkpoint, or you have a limit of how much wall you want to accumulate. And if you hit that limit, then Postgres is going to create a checkpoint so it can start removing some of the older wall files. Let's talk about how we decide that balance. So if your checkpoints are triggering too often, you will get this message in your Postgres log, which is checkpoints are occurring too frequently, consider increasing this. So this, I think, is a very good indicator that checkpoints are happening too fast. I think by default, this happens every 30 seconds. If checkpoints are happening more often than once in 30 seconds, you can also change this, change a config to tune how much you want your checkpoints to be spaced out before you see this warning. So the way an ideal checkpointing setup for a high write workload works is checkpoint should ideally be triggered with the timeout. And you want to set your wall limit to be such that it is not reached very often, which means most of your checkpoints are time-based and not wall volume-based. There are two main parameters which help tune these, and I'll talk about them specifically. The first one for time-based checkpoints is checkpoint timeout. The right value for checkpoint timeout depends on your recovery time objective, how much time you want to take to recover if your database crashes. It's hard to predict specifically how much recovery time would be, but it's a relationship between the checkpoint timeout, because checkpoint timeout will tell you how much, roughly how much wall you might have to replay. And you know, it's possible that the same amount of wall take different amounts of time, but it's pretty clear that if you have a checkpoint timeout of a day versus an hour, a day will have much more wall to replay, and it will likely take much longer to replay as well. The default for Postgres is 5 minutes. However, 15 to 30 minutes are very common setups. Also, if you have high availability enabled, you don't care as much about the recovery time, because then you can just fail over to the secondary and you don't need to recover the primary. So in those scenarios, it might be okay to increase checkpoint timeout to a higher value. And lower values, like setting it too low, essentially has the disadvantage of generating too many writes due to something called as full page writes. I'll discuss that in the later slides to kind of explain its impact on checkpointing. The second parameter is the max wall size. The way ideal way to set it is to measure the amount of wall you would generate in a checkpoint timeout period and set the max wall size to be a bit higher than that, like maybe 2 to 3x higher than that. That way, you are not necessarily triggering checkpoints very often due to wall max wall size, but you're triggering them due to timeouts. But if you have kind of a very a huge influx of workflow, kind of huge spike, you still are able to trigger checkpoints due to max wall size. Right? How do you figure out how much wall was generated? You can look at pgstat bgwriter, or you can look at the output of kind of previous checkpoints using log checkpoint to determine the right value for. One caveat for small workloads is if you set your max wall size this way, you are kind of assuming that you have enough disk to support writing of that much wall and retention of that much wall. For small work, let's say you have a 32 gigabyte disk and you want to set max wall size to a very high value. That's not a great idea, because it's possible that, you know, let's say 20 gigabytes of that is just gone because of max wall size. So you might want to use the second factor you might want to use when you're tweaking max wall size is deciding where exactly, you know, how much disk exactly do you want to give to your wall. Now, once you're triggering checkpoints at the right pace, it's important to have the checkpoint move at a right rate as well. Checkpoint obviously is an IO intensive operation. So if you're doing all the kind of IO at once, it's going to potentially lead to IO stalls, because you're kind of trying to fsync many files at once. Postgres provides a parameter called checkpoint completion target, which tells you what percentage of the checkpointing time should Postgres aim to complete the checkpoint in. As an example, if you have a 5 minute checkpoint timeout and you set this parameter to 0.9, it means Postgres will try to complete each checkpoint in 4.5 minutes. So that you have, it's good to kind of leave a little bit of leeway, because at the end of the checkpoint, you have to do very IO intensive things, and it might kind of take a bit longer than what Postgres predicts. So that's why I think it's good to set this at 0.9. Postgres's default now is also 0.9. So discussing this parameter is a bit less important than it would have been a few years ago. But if you are using Postgres, older versions of Postgres where this value is set to lower, I would recommend to up it to 0.9. Now let's touch on the concept of full page writes, which I mentioned in passing in a couple of slides. So Postgres by default has 8 kilobyte page size, and on the operating system on block size, and on the operating system typically it's 4 kilobytes. So what that means is when you write a Postgres block to disk, it's possible that it will be written to two kind of different file system blocks. And it's possible that the operating system crashes after you've written one and before you've written the second. How do you recover from that scenario? Because otherwise, you may be in a situation where Postgres kind of reads that block later and it leads to silent corruption or, you know, bad data being read. So it's important to keep full page writes on. But the implication of full page writes is that Postgres will now write the content of the entire page you're writing to wall after the first modification after a checkpoint. Obviously, as you can guess, that this leads to a great amount of increase in wall volume. Like normally, if you are not doing full page writes versus full page writes, it's not uncommon to see an order of magnitude more I/O being done because you have full page writes on. And you should have it on because it helps you prevent corruption. But it's something you need to know that, you know, because you're doing, let's say you do checkpoints too often, a lot of pages will be touched after the checkpoint and a lot of pages will have to be completely full page will need to be written to the wall for recovery reasons. And that will increase the amount of wall volume significantly. So now there are a bunch of other parameters which you can tune regarding the wall. The first one is wall compression, pretty straightforward. It compresses wall. You can choose between a few algorithm options. Like typical compression, it allows you to reduce the total amount of wall you need to write. Really helps with when you have full page writes and if you're not doing too many random I/O. You trade off CPU time for that. Now, when Postgres is writing wall, it uses a buffer in memory called wall buffers, which is defaults to, I think, 16 megabytes. It's the amount of shared memory which you use for writing wall before it's flushed to disk. If you're doing a lot of bulk loads or if you're doing many concurrent writes, you might fill that buffer with the, even within the scope of a single transaction or a single statement. That's why it's more beneficial to kind of increase it in certain scenarios, say up to 128 MB, to actually do less flushes of the wall in the middle of a transaction. Min wall size is an interesting parameter, commonly misunderstood. So I wanted to touch on it. When you have wall files in the directory, Postgres tries to make sure you maintain at least these many wall files in your directory, what's set to min wall size. Why is that beneficial? Because Postgres can then recycle those wall files. Let's say you make a huge write. Instead of having to allocate new files, it can just recycle those wall files because it will keep those wall files around. And that helps a lot between when you have spiky workloads. So during your spike, you're not kind of spending all your time allocating new files, but you can reuse the existing wall files. How do you decide what to set it to? You can look at log checkpoint output to kind of figure out how much wall you're generating and set min wall size accordingly. I'll talk about two other parameters. One of them is backend flush after. So when you have statements making a lot of writes, you make those writes and then kind of leave it to the operating system to decide when to flush them. That could lead to the operating system accumulating a lot of writes and kind of doing them in a big bang, which could lead to I/O stalls. That's why it's kind of, it might be useful to set backend flush after if your backends are writing a lot of data. What happens is after that amount of data has been written, Postgres will actually attempt to force the operating system to write that data. This has certain caveats, like for example, a situation where your data doesn't fit in shared buffers, but fits in operating system memory, you may not actually need to do as many writes to disk because you can maintain your working set in memory, but setting this parameter might cause unnecessary writes. So please look at the caveats of this before you decide to set it. And the last thing is something you set during initDB, which is the size of individual wall files. That might also be beneficial if you have very high wall volume because the number of files you need to manage within the wall directory can become very large. This can be set during initDB, so you kind of have to predict what your workload is before you do this. There's a bunch of other wall-related parameters. I haven't personally run into them as often or seen as much benefit of them as some of the other parameters, so I just decided to discuss these. The others, you can look at Postgres documents. Let's talk about the last kind of component we want to discuss in this talk, which is called background writer. Now, why do we need something called a background writer when you already have a checkpointer? Postgres uses shared buffers as its buffer pool, which means that any reads or writes which it needs to do need to pull things into shared buffers. Now, shared buffers is a limited resource. So when there isn't space to put new buffers in shared buffers, you need to evict something from shared buffers. If that page was dirty, which means if there were writes made on that page, you must write that data to disk synchronously in the middle of the query, because otherwise you just lose it if you don't write it at that moment. You can look at explain plans to kind of see that you will have written as one of the things in kind of the, when you do explain analyze buffers, That's what it indicates. So many times people get surprised, oh, I have a read query. Why am I getting written, right? So that's why you are having to write buffers, because your shared buffers is full. So that's where BGWriter comes in to write these dirty buffers occasionally. When clean buffers become insufficient, BGWriter empties, or I should say flushes some of the dirty buffers from shared buffers to make empty slots for you to pull new data into it. It increases the total amount of I/O, but the trade-off you're making is that your user queries don't need to synchronously do that I/O, and you can just do them in the background. What are the parameters which govern BGWriter's behavior? The first one is BGWriter delay. It's the time interval at which BGWriter wakes up to start to clean dirty buffers. How many it cleans in each cycle is determined by the LRU multiplier. Like the way you use the number of buffers BGWriter will clean is based on the average of how much it had needed to do in the average need in the last few cycles multiplied with the multiplier. So the default is 2, which means it tries to clean up 2x the buffers which it has needed on average to you know, make sure you account for certain spikes. Values less than 1 indicate that you are okay with your backends doing most of the writes as opposed to BGWriter. In terms of a max limit on the total amount of I/O, that's done by BGWriter LRU max pages. So how do you decide how to set these parameters, right? So it's a trade-off between the total amount of I/O you want to do versus the amount of I/O you want to do synchronously as a part of user queries. If you are seeing a lot of writes being made by your read backends and you want to decrease the latency, which is being increased by all these writes, you want to make BGWriter more aggressive, which means you want to decrease the BGWriter delay or increase the BGWriter LRU multiplier. If your goal is to reduce the total of amount of I/O you're doing, then it might make sense to do BGWriter lesser, make it lesser aggressive. You can do that simply by inverting the previous advice, which is increasing BGWriter delay and decreasing the multiplier. However, do make sure that you know the extra I/O is coming from BGWriter, because it may very well be possible that you know BGWriter settings are set to be aggressive, but you know if there are no dirty buffers, then BGWriter doesn't have much work to do. Well, there's a lot more you can do. I'm not going to cover these things in this talk, but you could tune shared buffers. Now, tuning shared buffers impact pretty much everything. So it's hard for me to do justice to it within this talk in the context of just writes. But it makes sense to sometimes tweak it larger for write-heavy workloads if you can fit them in shared buffers. You know, otherwise, it might, in some cases, make sense to have very low shared buffers to avoid the double buffering between operating system and shared buffers. In other cases, it might make sense to have, you know, a very high shared buffers to avoid that. So it, like, there are a lot of things and there are a lot of caveats. So I didn't want to go into as much detail in today's talk. You need to sometimes tweak the operating system, because now Postgres will start to push more I/O. But if the operating system is not able to keep up, then that is going to be a limiting factor. So for example, you might want to set data write back to on, or you might want to edit things like VM dirty background bytes. There are group commit settings and a bunch of other parameters, but I think the main ones are the ones I covered. So I would like to kind of end this talk by kind of reiterating why tuning write workloads is a bit trickier. Firstly, Postgres defaults are not that good for write heavy workloads. Also, the tricky part with write-heavy workloads is it's not actually always tuning a single query. So an explain pan will tell you some things about the query, but it won't give you very direct pointers on the fact that you need to tweak you know, auto vacuum or BGWriter or these other background processes. Whereas with reads, you know, if you it's more straightforward, like an index creation or things are easier to catch. And also, these problems actually accumulate over a long period of time. So if you have a write-heavy workload, your auto vacuum is not well-tuned, you won't see it on day one. But after several days, you will notice that you have a ton of bloat, your system is slowing down in general, you might, you know, run into the infamous transaction ID wraparound situation, and all of these are not going to be great scenarios. So to optimize Postgres for your write workloads, make sure you have the appropriate setup and follow the best application best practices. You should monitor your workload. It's very important before we go into tuning is to understand what's going on. Listen to the right signs, whether it's to the logs, whether it's to the explain plans, whether it's kind of looking at logs of the log checkpoint. Like, make sure you have the right data to make decisions around tuning. You can tune your Postgres parameters around auto vacuum, checkpointer, and BG writer to squeeze more performance out of the Postgres database. And then make sure you adapt these based on the monitoring. So keep those monitoring things up and try to adapt based on your changing workload as your write workload increases or decreases. And that's my talk, folks. You can reach out if you have any questions. Thanks for your time. If you have any questions, do reach out to me either via email or you can find me on Twitter. You can also ask questions in the Discord or on the Citus Con channel. Thanks a lot for your time. And it was great giving this talk. Bye-bye.